Praised be Jesus and Mary. Celebrate today the memorial of Franciscan martyrs, St. Nicholas Tavelich and companion martyrs who died for their faith in the Holy Land in 1391. Our Lord in the Gospel today speaks of the end times. And the end times remind us, they make us reflect on the necessity of saving our soul, of being concerned about the salvation of our own soul and that of others. And this is a lesson which the martyrs today teach us in an eminent manner. We have the accounts of their martyrdom, the account of their martyrdom written by a contemporary witness of them. And these accounts of the martyrdom are left for us, for our edification. We have them today so that we might read them, admire them, and imitate them if possible. In the lives of these saints, there is more to admire than to imitate, as we will see, but there is also a lot that we can and should imitate. Nicholas and his confreres, they were missionaries in the Holy Land, Nicholas and his confreres consulted at great length how to gain a rich harvest in the Holy Land at Jerusalem, by winning for God souls whom the devil was trying to seize. Putting aside all considerations of fear, they sought sound advice from teachers of theology and other well-qualified confreres residing in the Holy Land. What advice were they seeking? And we have to understand the context that whenever missionaries set out to work in lands, in Muslim lands, there was little hope, little prospect of getting any conversions. Usually the apostolate was limited to the few Christians who lived there, helping them survive, helping them to practice the faith, and not much more. Why? Because Islam defended itself with the sword. Anybody caught, apprehended in the act of evangelizing, any Muslim caught embracing the gospel, were put to death. That's the way Islam defended itself. But these apostles of our Lord, these martyrs, were looking for ways to evangelize everybody. They knew, wow, you know, there's so many people here who defend themselves from hearing the gospel by the sword. How do we evangelize them too? So they sought advice. The reason why we read these acts of the martyrdom is also because these saints have been accused of being imprudent in their martyrdom. Well, they asked for it. They instigated the Muslims to violence. Well, in that sense, Their canonization has proved this accusation to be wrong. If they were provocative, if they did provoke them, it was a provocation to think. It was a provocation to think, well, are you sure that you will be saved on the promises of Muhammad? Are you sure that the religion of Allah and of his so-called prophet Muhammad will save you? If you think you're in the right, are you willing to investigate the truth of what you say? It was a provocation to think. And the Muslims don't like that. So the martyrs sought advice as to how to evangelize them, and they supported their case with arguments taken from sacred scripture, with reasons they had gleaned in the course of their readings and the works of approved learned men. With strength from the Lord, they were confident that a person thus equipped with what? With scimitars and swords? No, with the word of God. As Pope Benedict XVI pointed out, you know, our God is not a God of violence. The way to convince somebody to become a Christian is by speaking to his intellect and to his will, to the higher faculties, not by threatening him with a sword. So thus equipped with strength from the Lord, they were confident to affront the combat. On November 11th, 1391, at the Feast of St. Martin, about the third hour, they decided to carry out systematically what they had long desired. They set out together, each one carrying a treatise written in common Italian and Arabic, and first made their way to the Temple of Solomon, but were stopped as they sought to enter. They were then brought to the residence of the Qadi, where they took out their treatises and proceeded to read them. The Qadi then addressed the four men in these words: "Have you spoken as sensible men in possession of your wits while you read, or did you act like madmen straying from reason and out of your minds?" It was not the usual thing to do. You know, as I repeat, the context was that of not trying even to evangelize Muslims in this way at that time in the Holy Land. So that's why he speaks to them. Were you speaking as madmen? Do you know the consequences of what you have done? Were you sent by your pope or by some Christian king? Calmly and discreetly, with great zeal for the faith and an ardent desire for salvation, The four friars replied, "We have not been sent by any man, but by God, who deigned to inspire us to point out to you the truth and the way to salvation, because Christ says in the gospel, 'He who believes and accepts baptism will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned.'" And St. Nicholas and companions were doing this also out of love for the faith and out of love for their neighbors, out of love for their Muslim brethren, whom they wanted to see saved, and salvation comes only through Christ. Then they point this out to them. Thereupon, the Qadi asked them, "Are you willing to recant and become Muslims and escape death? If you do not, you must die." They replied in a clear voice, "Under no conditions will we recant. For the sake of the truth and the Catholic faith, we are ready to die and to endure every torture, because all we have said is holy, Catholic, and true." Upon hearing this, the Qadi and his council pronounced the death sentence. The sentence had hardly been pronounced when all the Saracens present shouted loudly, "They must die, they must die." They beat them with whatever they could get a hold of until the friars fell to the ground as if dead. This happened about the ninth hour, and because of the popular outcry, people remained there till midnight. About the middle of the night, the Qadi had the victims stripped and tied securely to stakes and tortured so severely that their bodies became so weak that they could no longer support themselves. Then he sent them to a foul prison and had them bound to wooden posts so tightly that respite and rest were impossible while the torture continued. At last, on the third day, they were taken to the street where criminals were customarily executed. In the presence of the emir and the Qadi, with an immense number of Saracen soldiers standing by with unsheathed swords, and isn't this a familiar scene today? How many times have we seen this on the internet? With a huge fire burning, the friars were asked to recant and become Saracens and thus escape death. They replied, "It is our determination to proclaim to you that you must be converted to faith in Christ and be baptized. Be certain that for the sake of Christ and our faith, we fear neither death nor fire here on earth." When the Saracens who were standing there heard this, they were seized with frenzy, rushed upon them with savage fury, and hacked them into such pieces with their swords that no appearance of a human body remained. The severed pieces were thrown into the fire, but were not consumed. So throughout the whole day, the crowd stood around the spectacle and carried wood for the fire till midnight. They then scattered the ashes and hid the bones so that the Christians might not find them. Of course, not all Muslims are bad Muslims. That's not the point of this homily. The point is that we have to provoke them in a certain way. Not to violence, not by instigation to violence, but by a provocation to think. This goes for Muslims. Maybe we won't encounter many in our lives, although there's an increasing probability that we will. But this goes also for atheists, for Protestants. We as Christians shouldn't provoke anybody to violence, but we should provoke everybody to think about their salvation. Pope Benedict XVI, in one of his last, or if not perhaps the last address that he gave, which was on ecumenism, on interreligious dialogue, or on dialogue with atheists, as we could broaden the category, said that the Christian should never be afraid to navigate the sea of truth. The Christian should never be afraid and never forget to navigate the sea of truth. And if we speak somebody who thinks that they are in the right, whether they be Muslim, atheist, Protestant, Buddhist, whatever they might be, we should remind them that neither should they. We should remind them that neither should they be afraid to affront the truth. And if they are, and if they have to resort to violence because they don't want to think, well, then the next question is, do you think that such a religion can come from God? If God is truth himself, do you think he can command violence in order to forbid you from thinking, in order to stop you from thinking? To conclude, when I was in Austria some years ago, 3.5 years ago, as part of seminary formation, I was sent to Austria, and there I came in contact with Muslims. And in Austria, there are even more than in Italy. A lot of them good people, don't understand me wrong. But a lot of them, when they arrive in Europe and they're freed from the yoke of Islamic society, at the very least, they give up the religion and they feel liberated because they are allowed to think, because they're liberated from the yoke of basically a violent imposition of something, of a belief, against reason, against the will upon somebody. At the very least, they feel liberated. And if they have the opportunity, if they have the grace, if they have the chance to run into a Christian who actually knows his faith, who actually preaches his faith, who actually thinks it's worth convincing somebody about their faith, many of them actually convert and thank God for it. So may St. Nicholas and companions give us that grace to preach our faith in words and in deeds for the salvation of the world, for the salvation of all those who do not yet know Christ, for the salvation of all those who reject Christ, so that we might remind them, be a constant provocative reminder to the world that through Christ and through Christ alone we achieve salvation. And if we don't achieve salvation, well, then we waste our existences. St. Nicholas and companions, pray for us.